Hi, everybody. I'm Simon Cooke. I'm the commercial director of Pragmatic. I've been a designer for over 20 years, and I previously ran a creative agency with my co-founder, which we started back in 2003, and it merged with Pragmatic just over 2 years ago. But nowadays, I use my creative skills to help the company promote itself and win business. I still practice design, and you can see some of my work at this address here on Hello. But to give you an insight to the sort of person I am, I'm the kind of guy that has moments like this regularly, where kind of ideas pop into your head. And for me, it's pretty much the most exciting thing of my job. There's really no better feeling, and it's this feeling that's inspired me to try and tackle what makes a great idea and find out where they come from. So let's kick off with a quote. This is from a famous creative mind, Mr. Bob Dylan. Inspiration is hard to come by. You have to take it where you can find it. And the interesting thing about this is Bob seems to be referring to inspiration almost as a physical thing when he describes it. You have to find it. It's like it's hidden somewhere. You have to go looking for it. Except nobody really knows where it is. So the question is, where does inspiration come from? Where do ideas come from? And I think to answer that, we have to look at the notion of finding something. And finding something implies direction and location. It suggests that we need guidance, you know, like a map, perhaps. But before I go any further, I'm just going to a random fact, but stick with me, it is relevant. The ancient Greeks believed that creativity and inspiration, they didn't come from the human beings. They believed it was like a divine spirit called a daemon. And likewise, the Romans believed that a creative spirit followed each individual right through our lives from death to birth. Interestingly, they called it your genius. But really, modern thinking is that the genius lies within, so the path to creativity is kind of an inward-facing one, like a map of the mind, which leads me neatly onto mind mapping. What you see here is a mind map created in a bit of software called Mindly. Should be animating, but basically what this will show is this piece of software shows a walkthrough of this talk. It's the closest thing that I could kind of come up with to show the actual origins of design inspiration. And the mind map that I created kind of illustrates how design theories fit in. It talks about tools and processing of ideation. So to get started, let's start where I kind of started with this talk was looking at design theories. Now, there are many design theories around today. Only yesterday, John Maeder was talking about deep design. That was something I hadn't heard that phrase before. Kind of theories change over time. There are many kind of new theories coming out. There are ones that have been around for decades. And what's true of kind of most of these theories is that they evolve over time. With kind of the onslaught of technology, especially when we think about AI and machine learning, for example, it pushes the boundaries of these theories and forces us all to think about new ways, new directions. But generally speaking, with most design theories or methods, there's always a common place for ideation. There's always a place where ideas have to surface to the top. So for us at Pragmatic, we use a design method called design thinking. So many of you may already know of design thinking. It came from the 1980s and has itself kind of evolved over time. But what we know today about design thinking is largely attributed to David Kelly, who's the founder of the Stanford University's D School and also IDEO. And design thinking generally is split into five sections. So as I said before, some of you may know this, some of you may not, so I'll whip through them quickly. I won't dwell too much because it's the ideation stage that we're really interested in. Firstly, empathy, empathize. This is the process of kind of creating a deep understanding of the user's needs and understanding the context of the problem. So this is like the research and kind of data collection stage. And it comes before definition or define. And define is about clearly articulating a problem, and setting boundaries and creating the brief so your design team can carry on and kind of develop down a single direction. Next is prototyping. So prototyping is really about creating kind of lo-fi versions of the assets that to kind of quickly sense check. I mean, notice I've skipped ideate, we'll come back to that. But it's about sense checking your ideas, seeing them as quickly as possible to see if they really work. And lastly, testing. That's about testing those prototypes, getting feedback, and kind of starting into a kind of infinite loop of iteration, meaning that, you know, you might test something and your theory wasn't quite right, and you can loop back to definition, redefine that theory, come up with some new ideas and re-prototype, and it goes round and round and round until you kind of successfully achieve what you're looking for. So ideate. This is the bit we're kind of really interested in. This is the bit I'm focusing on today. Ideation, it's the process of idea generation. And the first point to discuss about ideation is tools. So some of the tools we're going to look at today, many of those you're probably familiar with, and I'm not going to teach you how to use these tools or even when to use them. It's really about the tools in the context of the ideation process, where they come, how they're useful. So let's start with sketching. Often the first point for any designer, you know, it's a place that I would immediately turn to for any kind of creative challenge. Sketching, for me, interesting really, because I see sketching as a kind of an output exercise. Sketching is about taking thoughts from the mind and rapidly transforming them onto paper. So just think of it as output. So if you ask yourself, is sketching where inspiration comes from? You know, I'd probably say no, not really. It's a tool for kind of recording it. Likewise, there's a tool here, Adobe Comp, which takes kind of sketching into digital. Again, I don't think it's the point of ideation. I think it's a great tool for speeding up that process, but not really where inspiration comes from. Mind mapping, saw this before, mind mapping. Much like sketching, mind mapping for me, again, is the process of taking thoughts from the mind, getting it down onto paper, or in this case, digital, it's actually interactive. But the good news is, there are some tools that can provide inspiration. So up here, these icons represent, you might recognize these, Adobe Capture, Muesli, Panda, and Colors, or Coolers, however you choose to pronounce it. Now the two on the end are used for creating color palettes, brilliant tools to kind of create complementary color palettes for your design. But the two in the middle, they represent tools that can provide content. These tools, these digital tools, can actually give you inspiration. They can give you input. So let's have a deeper look at one of them. So Muesli, I don't know if anybody kind of uses this. I started using this about 6 months ago. I think it's an amazing tool. It's a Chrome browser extension. And the way that Muesli works is every time you open a new window in Chrome, before you've typed in your URL or search query, Muesli will load a bunch of kind of creative content that comes from various sources, including Dribbble, Product Hunt, Tech Crunch, Behance, etc. So you can see how, unlike sketching and mind mapping, this is input. Brainstorming, another ideation technique, often the first point when a team would get together, it's the first exercise we do. So interestingly, brainstorming provides both input and output. So if you think about it, when you get together, members of the team, we all come with ideas, we all pull together, we all discuss those ideas, and there's some form of output. But there are some who believe that kind of brainstorming has limited value for ideation. This notion is backed up by this quote here from Tim Schiner. He's the principal designer at Salesforce. And this quote was published in the Design Thinking Handbook by Design Better. Tim says, "I don't believe the value of brainstorming is the ideas generated." And he goes on to say, "The experience of brainstorming creates a group of people with a shared perspective. And that is where the value lies." So I think I'd agree with that. There is value in a shared perspective, a lot of value in a shared perspective. Being in a design team and having been focused on the same direction is incredibly productive. But I also think that brainstorming is a point of inspiration, a point of ideation. And I think probably everybody here has experienced at some point when you're in a brainstorming session, an original idea happened there and then right in front of you. So to sum up, there are hundreds of tools available to help you with ideation. We haven't even touched upon social media, for example, visual tools like Pinterest and Instagram. But remember that different tools, you know, they may be equal in the value to design, but some tools provide more inspiration than others. So the second point of discussion in ideation is the process, how this kind of happens. And this, for me, is where it gets really interesting. If we think about how we work as individuals, we're all different as creative thinkers, your designers, developers, however you choose to kind of express your creativity. We all do it in a different way. So the way to think about kind of process, we start with our habits. We all have our own kind of different habits. These things that you do throughout your working day. So a friend of mine, I've known for a number of years, Jo Gifford, has recently published her very first book called The Brilliance Ignition. And it's about unlocking your creative potential. And in the book, Jo offers guidance on optimizing these daily habits. She calls them daily adventures. I love that term, really. She talks about how you can kind of tweak your daily adventures. Let's say you, every day, you go to the same coffee shop and you order the same drink and, you know, try going somewhere else, drink something different. Perhaps you read the same blog every morning because it comes to you in your email and it's easy just to click on that link and read it. Maybe explore, click on another link, follow, talk to a colleague, what do they read, you know. Explore a little further, kind of making room in your life for these little tweaks and listening to your colleagues and your community around you is extremely valuable. I'd say that changing these habits alone, the very act of variety, will enrich your life and kind of increase your capacity to be inspired. Rhythm. Rhythm or flow is a state of mind that most kind of creative thinkers would recognize. This is when you're in your most productive mode, when you kind of, maybe you're sat at your desk or you're painting or whatever you're doing, but it's all going perfect. You know, everything you touch kind of looks amazing. It all turns to gold. And rhythm is associated with timing, of course. So in my research for this talk, I spoke to a lot of creatives and asked designers when they felt most productive. So the vast majority of kind of feedback kind of was the same. There were some folks were slightly different. There is this peak in the morning, roughly 7 a.m. to 11 a.m., and it dips around lunchtime. We all get a bit sleepy after lunch. And then it peaks again around about from 4 till 9 p.m. So a little tip for designers and team leaders, perhaps, you know, if you've got to set yourself an ideation meeting, you know, maybe don't do it at 2 o'clock. It's probably not the best time of the day. In his book titled When, Daniel H. Pink explores this kind of very similar notion. Except, I mean, he really starts off thinking about mood swings. And it's a very similar looking chart, a rise in the morning, dip in the afternoon around lunchtime, and a rise again in the evening. So far, you know, we're kind of aligned. But Pink did a lot more research than I did, let's face it. And he concluded that this kind of curve is sort of split in two. So it sort of gets really interesting. So the morning spike is we're in a hyper-focus state of mind, which is roughly about now. I don't know, does anyone feel hyper-focused? No? I'll try standing up here. So in that hyper-focused state of mind, our brain is better suited for cognitive tasks like mathematical problems, organizing things, you know, rifling through emails and replying to people. And it turns out that from his research, most kind of aha moments, most moments of inspiration happen in the second peak between 4 and 9 p.m. And it seems that our creative minds, they kind of need a bit of time to relax, a bit of time to chill out. And it seems like having slightly less pressure on ourselves in those time zones, what we're able to do is our brains start to think a bit wider, and they start to kind of think about things that might have influenced us a few days before. And we start to connect the dots of what's in front of us now, what happened a week ago, what happened yesterday. And that's really, those connecting of dots is what sparks ideas. So I might be generalizing, of course. I mean, we're all different. But I'd say the kind of tip here is knowing one's own creative rhythm can really help you develop as a designer. So discover what this curve looks like for you. So the last point of ideation that I'd like to discuss is influence. And I've based the rest of this talk on kind of one notion, one equation, so let's hope I'm right. And that is that influence is equal to inspiration. Very much like energy transformation, what goes in one side comes out the other, transformed but in equal quantity. So in other words, the more influence, the more inspiration. So to help this explain this further, I've kind of broken this down into three areas of influence: how our digital environment influences us, how the physical world influences us, and how our community influences our creativity. First up, the digital environment. So this is a screenshot from my phone, roughly taken over about 2 days. What you can see here is a whole load of creative, visual and written content. And it's fair to say that this content is influencing my working life. And I don't consider this sort of content intrusion. I welcome it, and I'd be lost without it. So what you're looking at here is really the bedrock of my digital environment. But of course, there are other forms of digital content that influences. Blog posts, we all read blog posts. I picked this one out. This is from Sarah McHugh, who's the director of Shillington in the UK. This post was on Creative Boom, which in itself is a great source of inspiration. But as the title suggests, 50 of the best graphic design blogs for inspiration. And on that list, there's some big brands like Create by Adobe and Design Week. There's also some lesser well-known blogs. Like this one caught my eye. I think it was just the cool name and logo, HTTP star. I don't know, does anyone know this one? No? Maybe that's just the point, that by kind of reading a post, clicking on it, and taking one step further, I've managed to find some new inspiring content. And there are thousands of these around. Also on the list, WOGD. This is Women of Graphic Design. And it highlights the plight of women in what's, let's face it still, a gender-biased industry. But the point is that this post represents high-quality content. And I wouldn't have found it if I didn't change my daily habits a little bit, if I didn't go on a daily adventure. Audiobooks and podcasts. So let me tell you a little story. I work roughly 2 miles away from the office, and every evening I walk home. It takes me about 40 minutes to walk home. And I do this for the kind of exercise and headspace. But about 2 years ago, I started listening to audiobooks and podcasts. Now, the interesting thing about this is the timing. My walk home is at 5:30 or 6 o'clock, which is right at the peak of that second creative spike. And I can vouch for the fact that it really works for me when I'm in a kind of really kind of state where I can absorb creative content as I walk home. I find myself sort of stopping in the street and frantically typing notes in my phone. And when I get home, I jot a few more notes down and I put them aside and I can relax for the evening. And what I do is process those notes in the morning when I'm in my hyper-focus state. So top tip, if you don't already do it, if you have a commute early in the morning, for me it's the walk home, listen to podcasts and audiobooks. They're an incredibly valuable source of inspiration. Next up is the physical world. And kind of creative environments have become a bit of a cliche these days. I mean, does anyone have a slide in their office? Anyone? No? Good for you. This is Lego HQ in Denmark. Another random creative office space, a company, a creative agency called Cooke in South Africa. It's probably not dissimilar to the Pragmatic offices. What about this? I don't know if people kind of can recognize this, whether you associate this. But my point is the physical world is important. It's important because we should feel comfortable in our working space. But really this is about being in a state of mind. When you think about it, the physical world can't really compete with the volume of inspirational content that you receive in the digital environment. There just simply aren't enough spaces on the wall for cool typography posters or inspirational quotes. But of course, the working space isn't everything. The physical world is your home environment, when you're out shopping, cafes, restaurants, conferences. You know, you've only got to walk around this place. There's some insane typography going on the numbers of the rooms, etc., in this place. So my advice is really, you know, experience as much of that physical world as possible and allow it to influence your creativity. And lastly, and most importantly for me, is community. Now, by community, I mean people, of course. Your work colleagues, your friends outside of work, your family, clients, suppliers even. All these people form your personal community. These are some of the great people at Pragmatic that I work with, not all of them. This was taken at WordCamp Paris, WordCamp EU in Paris last year. And these people, they influence my working day, and they influence my kind of creativity, and they inspire me in a very positive way. So when you think about people, relationships, and influence, it's kind of obvious that the more people you connect with, the more opportunity you have for design inspiration. So, to recap, tools. Find the ones that work for you. Don't forget that some tools can provide you with input, others with output, and some tools can do both. Process. Enjoy a few daily adventures. Change your habits a little, but importantly, find your creative rhythm. And remember, influence is equal to inspiration. So I'd like to leave you with a challenge, and ideally you'd kind of complete this weekend. Many of you probably have done this already. I'd like you to talk to a friend, someone you know, or perhaps someone you don't know. Maybe you've met them this weekend. See if you can share some creative ideas, perhaps something you're working on right now. Maybe it's a concept for a brand or some designs you're working on. Maybe you've got them on your phone in your pocket or on your laptop. See if you can provide somebody else with inspiration and see if you can find inspiration from them. And make sure your visit to WordCamp is worthwhile. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Simon.
Pleasure.
Well, I'm inspired and influenced, I think, already. I'm sure lots of other people will be as well. If we have questions on the floor, just a reminder, our two mic spots are down here. So if you'd like to pop down and give a question. But there's no one there right now, so that's a great opportunity, because I did have a question I wanted to follow up with.
Sure. Yeah.
Everybody here is engaged with WordPress in some way or another, and it's probably fair to say that we all acknowledge that WordPress is an opinionated system, and it does have constraints within it. I have heard people dealing with constraints as part of the creative process, but I mean, how do you see them? There are upsides and downsides. How do you make the most out of that?
Yeah, I'd say constraints or restrictions, I mean, they're good and they're evil, aren't they? There are some that are really not required. So let's say you receive a design brief. And for example, if I was required to put a presentation together under the kind of branding of WordCamp Europe, and I could only use their fonts and their colors, it would probably be an unnecessary restraint on me. It would probably limit the creativity. But on the other hand, restraints can be extremely valuable. Uh-huh. So when you think about that design thinking process, that tends to come in the definition stage. So you've got your kind of research at the beginning, then you start to define. And those restraints can be extremely helpful. It helps define the problem, it helps pull a team together and
right.
put them in the right direction. So sometimes they're extremely valuable. I mean, you've just reminded me of a few weeks back, I was talking to a designer on the drive home from London, and the guy said to me, when we were talking about restraints, and he said to me, imagine that you're given a brief and you were limited, and the client said, I don't want to see a horizontal nav or a vertical one for that example, and I don't want to see a burger menu on mobile. Kind of feels really like horrible restraint, but the outcome of that might be that you're forced to be a little bit more creative about the navigation, so you can kind of spin that and turn it into
sure.
a good thing.
Sure. So embrace it, run with it,
focus with it.
Yeah. Okay. I still get to ask more questions. This is really cool. One thing I've been interested around, you're talking about get yourself into different spaces. And you talked about the physical space in terms of your office environment or your home office.
Yeah.
And the places where you meet with other people. Do you do other events, are there particular sorts of events you find alongside WordCamps that you find are particularly good for inspiration?
Recently the Pragmatic company has moved offices, and during that time we were kind of forced to go and work at a co-working space. And that turned out to be kind of incredibly valuable. It was a place in Brighton, and it was kind of full of a lot of different kind of creative companies. But just being in that space and kind of mixing with other people was, you know, was really enjoyed it. It's really valuable.
Yeah. No, I work at a co-working space myself, and I've got a lot more out of it than I thought I would. Yeah. I thought I'd get a desk and free coffee, but there's more to it than
that.
It's
true, yeah.
Although the desk and free coffee is a good thing. Yes, we have questions from the floor. Over there.
I just wanted to say to the audience, we have a pretty full house, so I've distributed mics along the back so you don't have to come all the way down forward. Check so if you have a question, just raise your hand and one of the people in a red shirt will come and get bring you a mic.
There is a mic just there for you, sir, if you'd like to come to the mic just there. That's right, that's the one. And over there, there we go. Comes in a rush now, yes.
Thanks, Simon, first. Second, I'm coming from the radio broadcasting world in my past life. And in that world, they say that all is invented. Do you think that inspiration is a form for rebuild things?
For rebuilding things.
Yeah.
I heard, so yesterday John Mayer said about, he used a cooking analogy, and I've often used this in the past, that with any, you know, especially in the design industry, there is only a kind of infinite amount of color palettes or fonts you can use or styles of photography. So I see kind of creative design as like cooking. You kind of split it down into the elements. So ultimately, we're reusing the same elements. We are kind of regurgitating what's kind of already there. But you know, that is design. So hopefully that answers the question.
Yeah. Thanks.
Thanks very much. And a question over here at the front. Yes.
Hi, Simon.
Hi.
Long time ago, I was the great graphic designer. Now I am very terrible. It's very simple. We surrounded with horrifying design.
Yeah.
And the clients too.
Yeah.
So we can't educate clients. Do you have any tips? How can we make some approach to explain our clients that this design is very important? And what is a good design?
That's a tough one.
tough question.
Yeah, it is a tough question.
Thank you.
So you're talking about this situation where you first meet a client who doesn't seem to value design, and before you kind of are able to kind of close that project or even you know win that work, you want to get that person on side. That you want them to value what you do, and that is incredibly difficult. In the real world, let's say, when you're selling your services as designers, it often comes back to value, and this is with my commercial hat on. If you can prove to a potential client that the value of design actually has a kind of monetary value to it, then you're probably on a winner. If you can show how the value of branding and designing and creative work and the quality of creative work can actually return in terms of achieving their objectives. Perhaps they want to hit a certain number of hits on the site and so on. So there are plenty of case studies out there about design value. So if you haven't got the time to maybe create that yourself, it wouldn't be a bad thing to refer that client to various case studies on the net which prove the value of creativity.
Okay, I'm gonna chip in with another question myself. Mm-hmm. So you touched on a few stages earlier around there and into ideation as well. And it was interesting to see you started off with the empathize stage. And so Kat, defining that research process as an empathic thing. We see the term empathy used increasingly as part of the process of creativity and design as well. Could you talk a little bit more about what you mean by empathy? Because it's quite a freighted term.
Sure, yeah.
And I think I'm particularly thinking of things in reference to Indy Young from Adaptive Path and her sort of practical empathy work she did there, which is sort of whole design techniques around that.
Sure,
as well.
Yeah. Well, I don't know that particular example, but I can tell you for us, for any designer, I think this is where one of the fundamental differences between creative design and what might be considered kind of purely artistic work is that design has a purpose. You're trying to solve a problem. So unless you know what that problem is, you don't really stand a chance of solving it. And the problem might not be clear. So empathy is the way of understanding what those issues are. And it's not an easy thing to achieve, just put yourselves in the shoes of your users. Just go, well, there you go, I'm in their shoes, I know what they're thinking. So it's generally done through like research, a lot of interviews or questionnaires, that type of thing. And the trick is to interact with perhaps people you wouldn't normally interact with, and make sure these surveys and questionnaires and interviews go out to the real users. And don't presume for one second that you can just step into their shoes and empathize with their problems. It just doesn't work like that.
Okay. Do you tend to get is it possible to get inspiration from that space as well?
Definitely. Yeah. Definitely. You'll discover so much about people, and that you definitely get those moments of aha, God, I didn't realize that was the problem. Yeah.
Okay, cool. If we are good for questions, we have up at the back there. Yes, hello.
Okay, is it working now?
It is indeed.
I have a very practical question. When you have a lot of creative thoughts flowing and you're getting distracted a lot because you have things going on throughout the day, I tend to just take whatever is near me and write it down or organize it, and it's really not very efficient. Do you have a favorite system for tracking and organizing your creative thoughts?
That's a really good question. Firstly, I'd probably like to refer you to, there's a book by Scott Belsky, who is the founder of Behance, called Making Ideas Happen, and it addresses that very point. It's about when, as a creative mind, you're flooded with ideas and you just can't cope. There's too many of them. What do you do with them? And like most people, I have a sketchbook or full of ideas, and some make it and some don't. So the trick is to record all those ideas. And one of the best things I like about that book is it refers to community, which is something that I spoke about in this talk. And Scott talks about how community can validate your ideas. So by simply letting people know about your ideas, your colleagues, your friends, the more people you kind of talk to, and if they're honest with you and feedback, you'll realize that some of them just fall by the wayside. They're not that good. People aren't interested. And other ideas, people, they want to be part of it. And that's a great way of filtering out what is, you know, what's necessarily an idea that doesn't really have much, you know, much validity to it, or an idea that's really going to make it. So, yeah, the trick is to share early and validate with friends, family, colleagues, and so on.
Share early, share often.
Yeah.
And get into a habit of it, I guess, as well.
Yeah.
Okay, if there are more, is that one more back there? You are around, I'm assuming.
I'm around,
you
yep.
are around. We'll yep. be over at maybe the happiness bar later on. That could
sure,
be a good
yep.
place to catch up.
Yep.
I should have checked, I brought it with me. There is, actually it might just be signing, like a Creative Tribes meetup as well in Andromeda. So that could be a good place to catch up and continue this conversation. I've really enjoyed this. I thought it's been an excellent counterpoint to John Mider's talk yesterday, exploring further the challenges and the techniques around design. Thank you very much indeed, Simon, and thank you for all of this, and thank you for the questions as well.